Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm Huck. Today we are doing my best books of 2021, which is always an exciting video to do. I have 5 books, some of them are series actually, to talk to you about today. I did struggle a little bit to put this list together because all in all, 2021 was kind of a mediocre reading year for me. There were not a ton of standouts. There were a few, so there are some things that I was very excited about to talk to you about, but I have my top 5. It was difficult for me to pick a top 5. I had like 2 or 3 that were clear standouts for me, and then after that I was like, I don't know what to put here. But this is sometimes a thing that I run into when making these like best books of the year lists, because I get kind of caught up in this idea that like these have to be like new favorite books or something like that, when that's not really what this list is. It's not that these are necessarily like favorite books as like of all time or anything, but of the books that I read in 2021, of those 82, which were the best ones, which were my favorites, or the ones I enjoyed the most. So with that disclaimer, hopefully I did not dampen any enthusiasm you have for this video, but let's just get started. So we're gonna go from my 5th best book to my number 1. So at number 5, a bit of a surprise, to me at least, is The Rainwild Chronicles by Robin Hobb. This is the first time a Robin Hobb series has made it onto a favorites of the year list for me, even though I've been reading her books for like 4 or 5 years now. And I always enjoy her books. They're always solid reads for me, but they don't always make it onto these lists. But this series I really enjoyed more than I was expecting. This is a series that I feel like is, people often say this is their least favorite series in the realm of the Elderlings, and I can understand why. I think part of that is that it is maybe the most unlike some of her other series. But I just had a really fun time with this. I read this whole series as audiobooks, which was a really good choice for me. I really enjoyed them as audiobooks. And I'm not sure if this is my favorite series of Robin Hobb's books, but what I really liked about this was that it had a lot of the same elements that I enjoy in all of her books, like her writing, world building, character work, all of these things, without some of the other things that kind of annoy me about some of her other books. And so I just was very pleasantly surprised by this. I had a really fun time with this series. All right, so now we're on to number 4 in this, which is also, like, I'm ranking these 5 to 1, but the rankings don't mean a whole lot. I kind of have like my number 1 is number 1, and then there are the other 4. They're not necessarily like super clearly ranked. But number 4 is Coffee Boy by Austin Chant, which is a little contemporary romance novella that I just had so much fun reading. It is about Kieran, who is a trans guy who recently has graduated college and started his internship at a political campaign, and he encounters Seth, who is the campaign strategist, who seems very like cold and prickly at first, but then the two of them get to know each other, a romance develops. It is just so cute and so fun. I enjoyed both of these characters so much, and I just really liked the way that they kind of played off of each other. And like, it's a very short novella. I think it is the shortest book that I read this year, if you can call it a book. I think it was like 60 pages or something, but it was such a delight. It was so much fun, and it just made me really want to read more from Austin Chant, which I then did, just because I really, really, really enjoyed it. Okay, next at number 3 is actually another contemporary romance, which is Act Your Age, Eve Brown by Talia Hibbert. So this is the 3rd book in the Brown Sisters trilogy, where we're following Eve Brown, who is the youngest sister of the 3 Brown sisters, and she has always been kind of known as the one who's like kind of a mess, and also kind of needs to grow up. And so when she makes one mistake too many and her parents get frustrated with her, they kind of cut her off and say, like, you need to find a real job and hold it down for over a year before we help you with anything again. And so she goes kind of spontaneously to an interview at a small bed and breakfast, which she initially does not do well in the interview and doesn't get the job, but then accidentally hits the bed and breakfast owner with her car, at which point they hire her because they kind of were out of options, because if he's sort of out of commission, they've already rejected like every other applicant and he needs help. And so she ends up being hired as the cook at this bed and breakfast, or as the chef at this bed and breakfast. And then of course the two of them, her and the recovering bed and breakfast owner, fall in love, have a romance, and it is just so like cute, delightful, heartwarming. I love Talia Hibbert's romances. The Brown Sisters trilogy as a whole was amazing, but Act Your Age, Eve Brown is my favorite by far of this entire trilogy. Just the characters are so endearing. I love their dynamic, and both of their characters were just so lovely and I loved them so much. It had a lot of romance tropes that I really love, and just Talia Hibbert, the way that she writes romances just have so much heart to them. Like, I don't know how to explain how happy this book made me, but it was just like ultimate like warm fuzzy feelings of happiness. So it was an absolute delight. All right, so book number two, or my second most favorite, is actually two books. It's more of like an author that I discovered and then read all of her books, which is Kay Ankrum. So I read three books from Kay Ankrum this year. My two favorites were The Weight of the Stars and The Wicker King, which actually both take place in the same small town. And these are contemporary YA. This one is like slightly in the future because it does deal with space travel in a very vague way. But these both, I'm just kind of putting them together because I think that I loved them in very similar ways. And really to me, it's that I discovered Kay Ankrum's books. That is the favorite thing. So in The Weight of the Stars, we are following Ryan Bird, who is in high school. Her parents have died and she is taking care of her younger brother. In addition to that, when she is at school, she tends to kind of find the outcasts of the school and take them under her wing, and she's created this little band of misfits who all care very deeply for each other, even though they are all very like angry, prickly people. And we're following her perspective when one day a new girl comes to school named Alexandria, and she is the daughter of somebody from a very famous space mission, which is this mission that was like going out into space and essentially never coming back. They were just going to go as far as they could and send back information for as long as they possibly could. And it is then about them finding out more about Alexandria and how she's trying to find out what happened to her mother, who was on this space mission, and helping her to like track down as much information as she can. And this definitely has like found family with these characters who all just like really would do anything for each other, and I just loved them. The other book is The Wicker King. This actually takes place before this one. They're not really connected. I read this one first, and you don't need to read one before the other, but there are characters from The Wicker King that show up very briefly in The Weight of the Stars. The Wicker King is about two best friends when one of them begins to have hallucinations of this like magical fantasy world, and he, from this fantasy world, he believes that there is a quest that he must go on in order to save this world, and also hoping that if he goes on this quest, saves this fantasy world, the world will kind of leave him alone. And so we're following these characters as, you know, his hallucinations get worse and worse, and there's always this, like, a little bit of a question of, like, are these purely hallucinations? Is he somehow seeing into a fantasy world? Like, are they real in some way? What's going on? Both of them don't really have, you know, adults in their lives who can really help them, so it's these two teens who are trying their best but are really struggling. And again, it just, it's like, has these really strong friendships, and it just, like, has, there's something about Kay Ankrum's writing that I find so compelling that just propels me forward in her books that I feel like I can't put them down, and I love her characters, and I'm just so glad that I found her books this year, and I'm excited to read more from her. All right, now we are finally on to my top number one best book of the year, which really is a series, but I really think that this series, you kind of need to, like, read them all together because it is something that is greater than the sum of its parts. But that is The Tenseret series by Neon Yang. The first book is The Black Tides of Heaven. This series was so surprising to me because I really didn't know what to expect from it. People kind of describe it as, like, indescribable and hard to anticipate what it is going to be because each book in this series is so different from the last. So this is a silk punk fantasy that takes place in this country that is called the Protectorate. The Protector rules the Protectorate. In the first book, we are following some of the children of the Protector who have been promised to a monastery in exchange for the monastery's support in preventing a rebellion. In this world, there is a kind of magic that is called the Slack, which can be manipulated by tensors, and that magic is very much kept to just, like, the upper classes and nobility. But there is a rebellion brewing among the common people that is called the Mechanists, who are creating different kinds of technology and weaponry in order to help them fight back against these magic users. So that is the rebellion that they're trying to prevent. So, as I said, in this first one, we're following these twins who are children of the Protector, and we're following them. We start when they are about 6 years old through when they're, like, 35. So in this very short book, we cover quite a few years. But we follow them as they are growing up and having, you know, significant moments in their lives where they really determine, like, who are they, and moments that are going to change their relationship. One of the things that is also really interesting about this world is that people do not are not assigned a gender when they are born. When they reach a certain age, around, like, late teens, early 20s, they kind of announce or determine what their gender is, but before that, they are generally considered to not have a gender. And so one of the things that we're following with these twins is also, like, as they're figuring out their gender and how that affects their dynamic and the way that it also affects just elements of their lives. This first book I really enjoyed. I think that Neon Yang does such a great job of depicting these familial relationships, these kind of relationships that already exist and we're sort of coming into the middle of them. They really just pull you into those relationships right away and make you understand them and feel the bonds between these characters. Then the second book in the series is following one of the characters from the first book later on in their life, where they are actually going through very intense grief, and they've kind of disconnected from life and really isolated themselves, but it is about them grieving and learning to kind of reconnect with the world and reconnect with life. The third book is told in sort of an epistolary format where there is kind of an experiment that went wrong and a bunch of people died, and there's a government worker who is writing reports about this like accident that happened. And so we're following those official reports as well as some of that person's private letters and writings and things. And then the final book is following somebody who knew the protector a long time ago when they were much younger, and they're sort of reflecting on their life. They're in a bar telling somebody kind of their life story and reflecting on their life and sort of how the protector got to where she is and became the person that she is. Anyways, so each book is very different. We're following different characters. The stories are told in very different ways, but Neon Yang just has this way of pulling me into story immediately. I love their writing. The characters that they create is such an interesting world. I have a full series review for this where I talk in a lot more detail about it, but it just is, it's just so cool. It's so interesting. I loved this so much, and I'm so excited to read anything else that they come out with. All right, so those were my top five favorite books or series of the year. I'd love to know what was one of your favorite books that you read or series that you read in 2021. I hope your reading was wonderful, but thank you all for watching, and until next time, bye!